could taste sweeter in this town. Could it be it's the same as the last? I swear I've seen your face elsewhere before, just as familiar as a bottle and a glass. Hey darling, sleeping on the blacktop. Hey darling, running through the trees, honey. Hey darling, leaving for the next town. Listen, my sets.
All right, welcome to episode 3 of the Back 40 Skull Session podcast. I am Shane Poor. I'm here with Christian Garner and Dawson Turbefield.
We've only cut this 3 times.
We've only, it's kind of hard to get our names right. Old Dalton and Daryl over there.
Daryl. Yeah. You ain't getting right. Daryl.
Oh, Daryl.
Daryl. It's grown partial to me in the last couple of days.
We are right in the meat and taters of turkey season here, boys. We are in the opening week here. Come on, Dawson. Focus over there.
Meat and taters.
We are in the meat and taters. We're in the good part of it. Turkey season has started here in North Carolina.
And it's in full swing.
It is in full swing. We got through opening week this week, which
we're here.
We're here, and we have had some birds being laid down.
Yes, sir.
In
We've
the first
got
couple weeks,
18 birds for the whole team of Appalachian
for the Hollow Hunters.
Between all our full time and part time guys, we've got 18 birds, which is ridiculous.
That's insane to think of that many birds being laid down.
We're
going to
be competing with Realtree Spring Thunder this year, pal. Best believe it. I think we're ahead of them, actually. If you count their states, I think, I could be wrong. Don't take it for sure, but I think they're at like 15.
Yeah, and still, unless you start counting how many of them are actually on camera versus how many we got on camera.
Yeah, we're a little bit beat.
Our guys,
but it ain't from a lack of trying.
It ain't for lack of trying. But we've been trying. We've been going with it. It's been an interesting week, to say the least. And we started it off with probably one of the funnest things I've ever participated in.
100%.
We had several of us go down to the coast and participate in the NC Strutmasters tournament. And despite talking all that trash, we talked. We can talk trash
and
with the best of
it. We talked a lot of it.
We talked a lot of it. We didn't win.
I think Sam done most of the talking, so we can kick it off on him. Yeah, he's a trash talker.
That was Samuel Gates.
We were modest. We're honest people. We're good-hearted, honest people. Sam,
don't lie. Don't lie. We went down there with high hopes.
We really did.
We were walking into, we ended up with what, about 1,000 acres to hunt?
Something like that.
I mean, we had
a lot.
We were throwing farms left and right. The guys down there were very generous with us.
Very. Some of the best people you'll ever meet in your life.
Oh, my gosh. They're super nice people. People that we have met, me and Samuel, through the pheasant hunt, and his dad lives down there. They're all friends of him. They're all members of the Shrine Club down there, so they're good men. And they put us on the turkeys.
They did.
And we had birds all over us, and we got one down.
Mm-hmm.
Had a mishap on another one.
I think we all should have tagged out. If we'd have stayed down there for a week, we would all would have tagged out.
Oh, you give us a week down there, we'd have been out of tags in North Carolina completely.
Easy.
But we had a good time.
Gosh, yeah. It's probably one of the funnest, 2 days, 3 days?
Probably so.
3 days. Yeah, Friday, Saturday, and we left Sunday.
Yeah, we went down on Thursday night. We went down on Thursday night, and Friday morning we went out and started scouting for birds. We found some birds Friday morning. Saw a coyote in one section of the field, which played in a little later in the hunt, that coyote sighting. It kind of had me and Christian fooled on that opening morning because we thought we saw it again, but we'll get into that story in just a minute. But
and then we had another coyote that tried to eat us.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, on Friday when we were scouting, me and Christian walks out to a field and just start calling a little bit. And the guys were, 50 yards behind us in the trucks?
Naughty. I mean, if that. I mean, right at 50 yards.
Yeah. And we just start calling, just yelping and stuff, try to see if we could locate a bird. It's in the afternoon. And Christian just grabs my arm. He's like, get your gun. I carry a sidearm on me all the time. And there was a coyote. He was coming to us. He thought we were
less than 10 yards to my left.
Yeah.
And he saw, obviously, he saw us. I looked him dead in the eyes, and he looked at me, and he said, buddy, you're eat.
Yeah.
That's what, I mean, there was enough time there between me and him looking at each other. That's what went down.
He said, you look pretty good.
That's how it felt. It was rough. I mean, I started around, and he was there. I was like, he's going to run. No, he's still coming. Shane.
Get your gun. He started to climb me like a tree. I wasn't sure what was going on.
I thought we was eat. I'll be honest with you. I ain't never been really scared of Cody or nothing, but I mean, that one was on top of us.
I don't know about care. Eight. We may have got bit, but we ain't going to get eaten. I'm
no.
I'm off.
Yeah, there's too much of me to be.
Yeah, I'm a pretty good sized meal for a coyote.
Yeah, my luck, it wouldn't take but one bite to finish and kill me off. So yeah. That one bite of rabies, that's all it takes.
Yeah,
done.
That'll finish get it. You. That'll just get you a few shots. You'd be fine.
No, actually, let's rephrase it. It'd been one of those deals where I'd have been bit, got the rabies, I'd been paralyzed for the rest of my life, and that'd be it. I'd have to live through the rest of it. Yep. That's my luck. Anyways.
Anyways.
Back to more important stuff here. We're only just a little bit sleep deprived, I think.
It's, nah, we're good.
What time is it? 9:30?
It's 9 something.
10 o'clock.
It's 10 o'clock on a
is
Saturday.
Is it 10 o'clock?
It's a Saturday night.
Yeah, but
is it Saturday night?
It is Saturday night.
We're a bunch
night.
Of girls. Yep. But no, I'll take that back. Every one of us has been out in the woods at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning the last little bit.
Yeah.
I have not.
Except for Shane.
I've been working.
Lame excuse.
But other than that, I'm just trying to build a future here, guys. But other than that, so we get through the scouting day, have high hopes. We get set up opening morning, and
let the fun begin.
Yeah, it was a little crazy. Me and Christian were set up together. Dawson and Samuel were set up together.
Let's rephrase it. Let's paint the picture here. We're set up on the same farm. Sam and Dawson are set up in one corner of a tobacco field, and that tobacco field is roughly, how many yards you say, 1,000 yards?
No. To the road.
To the road.
Yep.
Then there's the main highway.
Yep.
Now there's another field. It's probably
600 yards to the canal.
To a canal.
And
pretty
then,
deep thing. It's pretty rough.
Yeah, it was.
And then
nasty.
Another 500 yards, 600 yards to where me and Shane are sitting in another wood line.
In the wood line. And we could see to where they were.
Right. We could see it good. We could...
had a direct line of sight to them.
Give or take.
Yeah.
So we had to paint that picture, and you'll get was it wide.
Yeah, these are large ag fields. They were in the tobacco section.
Ag
we were,
field, not large ass fields. Let's get
I
that
said
across.
Ag I
had,
field.
I know. I had somebody ask me that the other day.
Oh.
Did he say large ass field? No, he said large ass field. Large ag field.
They were both. They were both large ag yeah. fields and large ass fields.
Yes.
They were both.
Yes, they were technically both. Yeah.
But anyhow, so we were sitting in the soybean field. We got in nice and early before daylight, sat down, and we're sitting there watching daylight come. Birds start gobbling behind us, right where we thought they were going to be.
About 50 yards, about, less than 100 yards.
Yeah, it was less than 100 yards. They didn't have a clue we were there. Everything's looking
promising.
It's
going to happen.
It's going to happen. And so decoy's out. We got the decoy set up out in the field. We just had a single hen out before daylight. I'm positioned. There's a road that comes out probably 40 yards to my left. And I was 100% sure that bird was going to come down, walk out that road, and just
and
it was
going to
be game over. Yeah, we had the camera positioned and everything.
But guess what?
It never
We're
happens that way.
And it don't happen that way.
So I start playing the sweet music of love to these turkeys, and they start gobbling and stuff. And I look up toward where Sam and Dawson were, and I see a black figure coming across the road. Now, the morning before, we had saw a black coyote in that same area.
Yep.
100% sure. I was like, well, crap.
And had the other coyote incident. So we've got coyotes stacked against
us.
Yeah,
we've
right
got
now.
Coyotes on our mind for sure. Mm-hmm. So I look up 500-600 yards, and, well, about 1,000 yards at that point. There's that coyote. I'm like, here he comes. And I told Christian, I pointed to him in the camera. I said, man, there's a coyote coming. He said, well, I said, that coyote's coming. So he spins the camera around and zooms in and loses his freaking mind.
That's an understatement.
Yeah, he starts screaming. He's almost yelling at me, it's a fucking turkey! It's a fucking turkey!
It's a turkey!
And I'm like, shh, 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 be quiet.
Be quiet. Just calm down.
So,
but I
Dawson, tell us where this turkey come from.
Well, it actually came from about 50 or 60 yards from me and Samuel.
More or less in his lap, he
yeah,
said.
Yeah, it was right there, gobbling on the roost all morning. Me and Samuel, about like Shane and Christian, it was a done deal in our book. We just had to wait for him to fly down, and it was going to come to us. And I was sliding my mouth call in my mouth to start calling, and I just hear, ow, 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 from forever away. And I'm like, Samuel, is that somebody else hunting, or is that like an actual hen? And he says, I don't know. And
And guess what?
Louder and louder.
It was in beautiful bone collector game calls from 2,000 yards away.
That's what we were playing from the 2,000 yards away.
It.
That's all that turkey was hearing.
And here he come. On fire. I look, and I'm telling you, nothing but thunder chicken.
So he flies down in front of Samuel and Dawson and runs.
Dead sprint.
Straight away from him.
He never let up. He come across the back of field, across the main road, and then halfway across the next field, he stopped and strutted up.
Started blowing up, strut, and the video is gorgeous.
You couldn't ask
I've watched everything except for when Christian touches it, and his hands are shaking. He's moving the camera.
I freaked out.
Yeah, he freaked out, and I was laughing hard at the footage.
You don't understand how heartbroken I was.
We've
done all these things. You got to think something we didn't add to that. I flew in from Florida to come for this mess, which I did. It was a whole mess. Long story short, I didn't think I was going to make it. I did. And now we're here, and in this moment, we're going to have these turkeys coming. You hear, it's a coyote. Well, that just shatters every little bit of hope I had. Here we go. Just like my last year's hunting went, filming these guys, I filmed, and the hunt gets crushed.
Yeah.
And here we go, starting off 2021, North Carolina, the same way, crushed. So I was like, here we go.
And it's not only turkey season, it was Strutmasters.
It was a lot on the line, $15,000 on the line to be exact, and much more. But anyways, I put the camera up, and I'm like, oh, he don't know what he's talking about. Nope. And here comes
the goblin. Well, I couldn't see. All I seen was something black coming. I just assumed it was that coyote.
Well, that's what I figured. Like, well, he said that. And I just assumed our chances was over.
In my mind, there was no way anything else could have been in the middle of this field crossing the highway. There's no other thing that it could have been.
Right.
And then you zoomed in, and then I seen it blow up. So he comes on across the field, crosses two canals, gets to 100 yards, and stops. And he looks to his left, our right, and blows up and starts heading that way. And we look over to the right. There's two other gobblers in the field, probably, 300 yards from us?
Yep.
Something like that.
Strutting. And then on top of that, I hear purring and clucking behind me. And here comes a gobbler about over top of my head.
Yeah, I look between Christian's yards above me. Arm when he's holding the camera and his shoulder, and I see the turkey come out of the woods. I'm like, holy crap. And there's nothing I could do. I couldn't shoot across him. Yeah. I mean, the turkey come out at 15 yards and run straight to him.
Straight to
the gobblers.
And
didn't even
how far
look
do you think that
hen.
Was from us to where those gobblers are in the corner of the other field?
About 300 or 400 yards.
At least. I measured it out. I think it's like almost five. It was up there. It's a long way.
Anyway, at this point, we're like, what the heck do we do? There's no clue what we do. And so I just start just raking down a slate call, just purring it like crazy. I mean, the video, it sounds like I'm an idiot calling, but it worked.
It worked.
I went to raking that slate call, and son, all four of them turned, and here they come on a rope.
I was about to say, if you wouldn't have done what you done, it was over.
Yeah,
we would have to completely got up and moved and hoped we could get in front of them in that big, thick mess of what you'd call woods behind us.
Yeah, and it was just...
And there was no way to do it.
It was a desperation move is all it was.
Right.
And it worked. It drug them back 500 yards. And
as if 2,000 yards wasn't enough, let's call them another 500 yards back to us.
Yeah, because there's just not enough sport in calling them 2,000 yards.
No, if you don't call them in at least 2,500 yards each time,
you might as well put the call up. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the first two that come across were the smaller of the birds, probably 7-8-inch beards. Come across, cross the ditch in front of us. It was out of piece. It was going to be a long shot. And then here comes the big tom that we caught from over at you guys and then the other bird. He was the dominant bird on the field, for sure. He was the strutter on the field. He was the dominant bird. And I had switched over left-handed at this point because they're coming in from our right, and I'm thinking they're going to come in and give us a shot. Well, they turn and come parallel to us, parallel to the tree line. And the first one crosses the ditch and starts working his way away from us. And I look at Christian, and by this point, I'm just frustrated. I'm like, this is horse crap. I've called these birds 2,500 yards, and he's going to hang up at 75.
And it felt like we've sat there for 2 hours.
Yeah, I mean, it felt like this was going on forever.
We recorded for, I think, like 40 minutes.
It was a while.
Nothing but calling. Yeah. I mean, calling. Wait a little bit. Yeah, call it.
My jaw was about to lock up at this point.
It's rough.
I'd had enough. And I looked at Christian. I said, how far do you think it is?
And like you said 60 or 70 yards.
60 or 70 yards. I said, screw it. I'm going to try it. When he comes across that ditch, I'm going
to
try it.
We didn't have no other choice but to try it.
Well, the other
gobbler
bird
behind
was
him, he was starting to figure out what was going on.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was going to follow the mother ones out. And
So he stepped across the ditch, and I slung $45 worth of TSS at him. I dusted his feathers, but it didn't kill him. He went 100 yards, hit the ground, went into the woods, and we never saw him again.
Yep.
And that was pretty much the end of that story.
That's basically how it went down.
That's how that morning went.
Let's
rephrase that. There's more to that, because we get out. There's actually a lot more to that. Now that I think about it, that's true.
Because
we get out, and we give it some time, and we get up, and we start walking back to the stealth. About, I don't know, 75 yards from the stealth. So we have to jump back out of the stealth set up and hope we can get something coming. Yeah, it's one of those other gobblers.
The bird that was with the one that I shot at, he was gobbling, but he was not the dominant bird there.
And no.
I'm still convinced that other bird's probably laying in that block of timber somewhere, but so we never found him, so it doesn't matter. Yeah, I mean, so we fed the coyotes, but probably 30, 45 minutes.
Right, and it's not a huge patch of woods, but it's thick.
It's very thick. It has a bunch of down pines in it, and every slab of bark looks like a turkey laying there.
Yeah.
But while we were in the woods looking,
Doing an Instagram live,
we hear across the field. Me and him both immediately start freaking out because we knew what happened.
Me and Samuel, after hearing all the birds gobbling across from us and us sitting there tapping our feet looking pretty, we finally decided we was just going to get up and go meet up with you guys and help you look for that bird. And we get up and start working our way towards the road, and we hear a gobble. This is after we had called a couple jakes into us, but they, you know, just playing around with them, you know. And we were walking out, and we heard a gobble, and Sammy looked at me, and he said, "Was that them jakes?" And I said, "I don't know. It didn't sound like it." And so I called, and he answered me, and I said, "No, I don't think it is." So we slipped down the edge of the timber, and by this time I can see the bird. Samuel can't, but I can. And I knew I could see that one had a beard. I knew it was a shooter. And we start working through the woods. I just flipped the camera on and start working our way. And as I'm going, I'm just calling real light, and he's gobbling his head off. We finally get to the edge of the woods on the other side, and by this time the bird's pulled away from the other turkeys it was with and started easing towards us real slow. And I called one more time, and it gobbled, and another bird gobbled that was with it. And so I'm obviously a nervous wreck. I'm tore all to pieces. Samuel's back there, you know, cool, calm, collected. I'm like,
that's just the way he
what
is.
What are you doing? You know, get jacked up a little bit, please. But we get up there, and this bird's coming, and it gets within 40, and I whispered Samuel, and I said, "Stand up," and he didn't hear me. And so the bird keeps coming, and I say, "Stand up." And by this time, the bird's like 15 yards. I mean, he is like
on top of in your lap.
Yeah, I was about panicking. He was so close. And he stands up real slow, and about the time he stands up, the turkey sees him evidently and starts putting. And in a video you hear me, I just say, "Shoot, shoot, shoot," and he blowed it down. I mean, rolled it. And in the video, I smacked him on the arm. I said, "Heck yeah," and then I just take off in a dead sprint because that bird's flopping. I thought it was getting up, but I ran up there and grabbed it, and it spurred the piss out of my hand. So
that's about right.
Yeah.
But, and Samuel's just standing there saying,
"Yeah,
all right.
All right, turkey.
He was just like, "Cool.
Cool. Yep. All right. We done it. Yeah. Done what we come down here to do. That's all there was to it.
I mean, he was the one talking to me. He said, "We're going to go down there. We're going to kill the biggest bird. We're going to win. That's all there's to it." Well, he done his part.
He done his part. That's 100% all there was sure.
To it. Yeah, he pulled the trigger.
He's like, "Well, guys, now it's up to y'all. Everything's
so
up to you."
We all get together. We come out of the woods, and I call them, and they're shooting video, doing a recap of everything. He's like, "Hold on a minute." Just set his phone down. And I hear him say, and he smoked him. And I told Christian, I was like, "He just said he got him. He just said he got him." We come like flying out of the woods.
I could hear you screaming through the phone.
I'm like, "Talk to me now."
I about got.
But he's real anxious to know what had actually happened.
Yeah.
Well, I couldn't tell. You answered the phone and said, "Hold on." And I could hear you talking.
Yeah.
But I couldn't tell by your tone whether or not it was a hit, a miss. I mean, right. We knew you shot at one.
Yeah.
But I couldn't tell. Yeah. And I'm sitting there listening like, wait for it.
Wait for it.
And then he said, and he smoked him. And I just lost it. I just start yelling.
Awesome.
I just start yelling.
That was actually the first. I've called a bunch of turkeys in. You know, that's my thing for a while was I just liked hearing birds gobble, you know.
Yeah.
So I've called a bunch of birds, you know, within shooting range plenty of times. But I have never called one until that one in and somebody actually kill it. So
yeah.
It was just as much rewarding to me as it was him.
Man.
So,
gosh, yeah.
I can't tell you how good it felt to walk over there and see that bird, too.
Yeah.
You talk about.
After what we'd been through.
Well, and so much weight lifted off our shoulders because you go down there with high hopes.
Yep.
But also high expectations. You've got a lot weighing in on you. I mean, we're representing the whole team down there.
Absolutely.
And we need to show up with something. Right. I mean,
you've only got one day to do it. Well, let me rephrase that. You've only got a couple hours to do it. You got from sunrise till about 3:30, because then you got to be going to weigh in.
You
got to
get it down there and get it weighed in, and it's a lot of pressure.
It's a lot, and
we weren't the only ones struggling that morning.
No.
We were keeping up with Culpepper and the guys with Spring Thunder.
Yep.
And Waddell and the guys
were really competitive.
As far as us and them, yeah.
Yeah.
Except for that guy that was hunting Jurassic Park. I mean, everybody else was pretty close.
Yeah, the guy that brought in his pterodactyl.
Yeah.
But he shot in front of his kids, probably. I'm sorry, that's a little deep one. But, I mean, that was a hilarious.
We'll get into that in just a minute, too.
Yeah.
All right, guys, I think that's a good spot. Let's take our first break, and we will be back shortly with the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast. This segment of the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast is brought to you by Bone Collector Game Calls, the official game calls of the Appalachian Holler Hunters. Whether it's locator calls, turkey calls, or deer calls, you can find all your calls at bonecollector.com, proudly made in the USA.
Man, are you tired?
Dude, I'm killed.
Man, how can you be tired? It's opening day of turkey season.
I know, we've been scouting all week.
Man, take one of these rowdy energy. Hit a lot of fire under you real quick. That's better now, ain't it?
Oh, yeah.
Now we'll run through the woods like a madman.
Like a Cheeto on cocaine.
Let's go get it.
Let's get it.
And welcome back. We're back from break on the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast. And we were in the middle of telling about the NC Strutmaster story. So we got finished with the opening morning success.
Yeah.
So we've still got tags, and we've still got time. At that point, it was only about 7:30, 7:45.
Yeah, it's still early.
It's still plenty early. And so we still got time. We're going to keep pushing, keep trying to find another bird because, I mean, the more birds you take to the weigh-in, the better. You can take two there, and you got a better chance, which the one we had was a pretty solid bird.
Yeah.
The one that I shot at that morning was probably a little bit better, but wouldn't probably have beat it by much.
Right.
Not enough. Well, looking back, probably not enough to
win. No. It wasn't going to be. Well, we never saw anything
I'm
that
saying
day
that
was.
You know, like,
well, yeah. But we never saw anything that day that would have won that competition. But anyway.
I did.
Nah, I don't know about all that. That bird's getting bigger the more times we tell it. He's a fisherman. Yeah. You can tell that story's getting closer to the camera.
Well, yeah, we'll get to that in a minute.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a minute. But so we get back together. And at that point, did we go down to Russell's?
Yes, we did. We left from there, and it's like, well, the next best thing we can do, we went and got pictures.
Yeah.
Pictures of the bird, showed it to Buddy.
Yep.
Who's a great human being. Yeah, really.
Buddy's a great guy. He is a number one guy.
I
told you guys you would like him.
Yeah,
he's awesome.
I mean,
he's a heck of a man.
He is a heck of a man.
Speaking of said man, he got us hooked up with one of his buddies who lives down the road. Named Russell. He's another farmer. And he just happened to he called and said, hey, we've got a bird.
Yep. In the field down here.
Yeah, he's like, hey, what are you doing? Because I've got a turkey down here in this field right now. Oh, here comes a static bag.
It's all right.
Anyways, that's what's going on now. He's like, hey, sorry, that's really bugging shit out of me.
It's all right. Keep on talking. But he called and he said, we've got a bird in the field. Get the boys down here and see if we can get on it. And so we jump in the truck and take off. It's, 3 miles down the road to his house, if that. And so we get down there, and he says, come down past the greenhouse to the second field. We go down there, and he said the bird just went in the woods over. So me and Christian grab some decoys, start hustling down this road and get through the open spot where the bird could see us and get over and set up in the edge of this little ag field. Well, I say little, this big ag field.
It's a big field.
But we were in a little corner of it, and it was beautiful. I mean, the setup we had was absolutely gorgeous. And I sat down.
Trees bloomed all around us. I mean, it's perfect springtime
setup. Well, and you had some limbs down and stuff, a good place to hide. It was going to be perfect.
It was perfect. Until the tractor
comes by. We sat down, and I start calling, and the turkey just starts hammering. Back in the woods, starts just gobbling his head off. He's coming our way. And I look up, and he's not the only thing coming our way. We had about a 250-horse John Deere tractor pulling a set of plows behind it coming right at us, too.
Yeah.
And he literally come right to us in the field, turned around, and started making his lines back and forth.
And then pulled said tree that I set up behind, almost with him.
He hooked the tree in the disc, right where Christian was sitting. And he started down the field away from us. So I thought, I got 5 minutes.
Right.
Or maybe 2 minutes.
Right.
I start calling. The bird starts gobbling, and he starts coming toward us, and he gets almost to the wood line, and then here comes the tractor back. So I have to shut up because the tractor's turning around 30 yards from us.
Mm-hmm.
He turns around, heads away again. I start calling. The bird's moved away, and he starts coming at us again. And after about three times of this, I finally just throw in the towel.
Well, he finally starts moving away.
Yeah, he started moving away, and we go over there. We go over there to where the guys were, and they said, look in the far side of the field. He's over there somewhere on the far side of the field. So I told Christian, I said, I'm just going to have to fly this one solo. And I take off across the field and have the scoot and shoot decoy with me, and I see the hen. And so I hit my knees, and I just start crawling with that decoy. And the hen sees me, and I look back behind her, and there's the gobbler.
Yep.
And they weren't 75 yards away. I'd already tossed up one Hail Mary. I didn't have that many shells left. I wasn't going to try it again. And so I start shaking the decoy at him, and he looks at it, and he turns, and his head turns red.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm thinking, this might actually work.
Right.
And then that hen just, is all she done. And he turned and went right behind her.
Yeah.
And that's all she wrote on that one. That was it.
That's that field done.
Yep, that field was
done. On to the next one.
Yeah. So we move on to another field. And we pull up to this field, and we saw some guys sitting back at the road, just hanging out at their truck, talking on one of the neighboring properties. And we think, well, they're done hunting or whatever.
We're trying to debate what they were doing. We're trying to figure out whether they're going to hunt or not. We didn't want to step all over top of them.
Well, that's it. But they weren't.
Yeah, we'd come to terms that, no, they're done hunting. We're free to go in here beside them and start calling.
Which they were not hunting the property we were hunting. They were hunting the adjoining property.
Right, which is close enough. You still don't want to tick anybody off, you know, best you can.
Yep.
Or at least we don't, unlike some people that fish around Avery County. Sorry. Anyways.
So we go to a little side field. We get out to the edge of it, start calling, and turkey starts gobbling on the other side of the field on the neighboring property. And so me and Christian start working our way around the field and get to the edge and look, and I hear somebody talking and look over, and here comes those guys running out through the field because they were standing at the truck, heard us get the turkey gobbling, and here they come, and they run in there talking and all that. And so we just turn around and pull out of there. Mm-hmm. We get out of there. It was the same field where we had seen the coyote the day before, and there just wasn't nothing good going to come about that. And, of course, we get back in the truck, and we try a couple other spots around that big old field because, I mean, that's a really large area.
Yeah.
There could have been more than one bird. Didn't hear anything. Get back out to the road and drive by those guys. And, of course, they're pulling up their turkey stakes because, guarantee you what happened, they run up through that field raising Cain, blowed him out of there, and that was the end of it.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's all there was to it.
That's all there was to it, so... By this point, it's pretty close to lunchtime.
Yeah, it is right at lunchtime.
Yeah, so we jump in the truck, and we're headed back to Buddy's house. Going to grab some lunch and just kind of hang out and get a game plan together. At this point, we're not too concerned with killing another bird. If we were able to find one pretty quick, we would have tried it. But we've got one in the cooler. We're in good shape. We've got something to go weigh in.
Something to show up with.
Yep.
To show off that, hey, look, we're here.
Yeah.
We competed.
Yeah, we done well.
We participated.
So we go back and eat, and me and Dawson decide to jump in the stealth and just ride back to the back side of the property just to call a little bit.
Whoa, hang on. Let's rephrase it. We didn't are chilling. We're like, we're going to ride out here and just see if we hear anything. If we hear something, we'll come get you, to the camera guy.
Who was almost asleep.
Yeah.
And didn't look like he wanted to move.
That don't matter.
Well, obviously it did, because you're like, yeah, that's a good idea, I'm going to say.
And I sat there and I was like, and as soon as those words come out of my mouth, I was like, I'm going to regret this for some reason. Yep. Whatever. If I get something, they'll come back. We're going to go.
So we get in the stealth and we go to the back side of the property and we stop at a little intersection and we call and one hammers.
Yep.
So we just jump out, head up this road, get around the corner, call again. He hammers again.
And he's closer.
And we get around this little puddle and just, you just barely called.
Yeah, I mean,
and he's on top of us and we're like, oh shit. Sit down. There was no time to prepare. It was just sit down right where we're at. So I just look over. There's a tree without a ton of briars around it. I set up against it. And I've got a road to my right and left. I can see 50 yards in both directions. So I figure we're in a good spot. And he sets up 10 yards in the woods or 5 yards in the woods.
If that, yeah.
There was a random mound of dirt. I swear, we run into so many freaking random mounds of dirt in the woods. But there was a mound of dirt. And he plops up on the other side of it, and all I can see is his eyes peeping across that mound of dirt from where I was at. He was hid really well, but he couldn't see up and down the road.
Nope.
From where he's at. So I'm like, well, I'm in the driver's seat here. So he starts calling, and the turkey's coming, and it's sounding like he's going to pop out to our right instead of our left. So I swing around, aim up the road to the right, and instead of coming out in the road to the right of us, he turns and comes straight at us.
Yep.
And gets within 10 yards. Spitting and drumming. You could hear every step this bird. You could hear him breathing pretty much. I mean, he was in our lap.
Yeah, there was like a 2-foot opening between trees. I seen the bird walk by. I thought he was going to come out up the road like Shane said. And then Shane pointed and I thought, well, Shane sees him. He's definitely going to step out in the road. And then I don't know, 30 seconds goes by, and the bird steps back in that open, and he's blowed up, and I instantly start jerking all over. And I thought, yeah, Shane's getting ready to bust him, because he was on top of us.
He was in our lap, and I never saw the bird.
Nope.
When I was pointing, I could hear him walking.
Yeah.
I flipped my safety off, because I knew at any point I had a wad of trash where they had pushed that road out. They had just pushed it over to the side.
Yep.
And he was right behind that wad of trash. If he would have went 5 yards one direction or the other, all he had to do was just step out. And he stood there, and he stood there, and he hammered, and he spit, and he drummed.
And I'm looking at him.
And Dawson
staring at him with and no gun.
Why he didn't bring a gun, I mean, I never even thought about it. We just jumped in the buggy and took off. And about halfway to the wood line, I looked at him, and I thought, we were to take 2 guns with us. We probably ain't going to find nothing anyway.
Yep. That's how it always happens.
Boy, was we right.
Always.
And tell them about the size of this turkey.
It was a giant. I'm not going to lie about it. It's the biggest turkey I've ever caught in.
I can honestly not tell you what it was because I never saw the bird. But
I say its beard was dragging the ground, I mean that literally.
He never walked out into the road. No. He never walked out from behind that clump of whatever he was behind whenever I was sitting there. And I heard him cluck a couple of times. And then I heard him start walking away. And so I'm up in the gun thinking he's going to step out left or like when he's going away, he's going to veer one direction or the other. He literally went straight away. I never laid eyes. I never saw movement.
Six.
He was 10 yards. That's how thick it was. I never saw the first like movement of anything.
And I was sitting there like, Shane, are you going to shoot? Shane, are you going to shoot? Shane, shoot him. Shoot him, Shane, shoot him.
Nothing I could do. Nothing. So we stand up and he's all to pieces.
He's like,
I can't believe that. I mean, he's all to pieces. I was like, well, let's go on down here and we can cut across and maybe we can get in front of him. Because he was headed back toward the field where we were at that morning. So we went down about 200 yards, cut across, come back up probably 100 yards, And there's an intersection up there. So we stopped probably 30, 40 yards short of that intersection. And I looked at him and I said, let's just walk right up here and let's call a few times, see if we can't hear him coming back this way. We walked up there and we stopped. And I yelped a couple times. And the bird's standing 30 yards from us. It takes off like a freaking jet. Yeah.
God's sakes.
And he just starts cussing. Yeah. And I'm just, I just start laughing. I'm just like,
what do you do?
Well, there's nothing you can do. Because once again, he was just inside, out of the road.
Yep.
In that thick mess. And we never saw him until he started flying.
And that's it.
And he literally lifted off. Last time we saw him, he was clearing the canopy of the pines. He was going to another county.
Oh, yeah. He was out of there.
Yeah, he may have headed to Strutmasters himself. I'm not sure. He was leaving, though.
Yeah.
I looked at him, and the only thing I said is, well, I don't think we'll get on that one in the morning. That was literally the only thing I had to say about that.
I mean, what else do you say?
There ain't a lot you can say about that.
I don't know. There's a lot Dawson said about it.
Yeah.
For the people that hasn't got to see a lot of Dawson yet, because he hasn't been able to be on one of our episodes yet for Holler Hunters, aside from talking on our podcast and stuff. Well, aside from listening to him, he's pretty monotone, pretty calm, relaxed, laid-back guy.
You know,
I don't think I've ever heard that much more.
He's very blessed.
Yes.
I'm very blessed, actually.
There we go. This kid had more excitement than him. Telling us about this bird. He was fired.
He was mad. He had nightmares about that bird that night.
Yeah, tore up from the floor up about this bird.
That one, it genuinely bothered me. it did.
He's over here stretching. He's getting all tore up thinking about it now, boys. Man, I'm telling you what.
Well, that's just the thing. You spend enough time in the turkey woods, you're going to get used to seeing that side of them going away, especially if you do any guide work.
Right.
Oh, my God. I've seen so many birds leave. It's ridiculous. You're just like, well,
here we are.
There goes another one.
Yeah.
Gone.
Yeah. We'll get paid twice for that bird.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. There you go.
But anyway, that was the last bird we got on that day, on Saturday. And so we go back to Buddy's and we figure, let's cut our losses, change clothes, take a shower, let's get ready to go. We're going to have a good time. So we drive up to the Snow Hill area. It wasn't. The address is not in Snow Hill, but we were right in Snow Hill.
Right. Same thing.
And
tomato, potato.
Yeah, it's all the same thing.
It's all flatland country.
It's very flat. But
yeah.
So we get up there, and we've made it to NC Strutmasters. We've got us a bird, get to park in the team parking, which is right across from the VIP parking. They take care of us.
Yeah.
They took care of us when we were down there. We go, and we weigh in. And we're cutting up, and we're having a good time. They've got music playing, and they've got all kinds of raffles and giveaways and stuff. And so we get there, and we look at the score sheet, and oh my gosh.
Ridiculous.
The monsters that they had. They had three categories that paid out. They had the biggest single beard turkey, which won the grand prize of $15,000.
Yep.
And then they had the biggest multiple beard turkey,
mm-hmm.
and then the biggest bearded hen.
Biggest.
All right, so the guys, let's start with the multiple beard turkey.
Giant.
It was
you walk up to the
four
stage.
Four beards.
And you see him
standing
there.
And he's hanging there.
My God. That's the pterodactyl we were talking about.
He wasn't standing there. He was hanging there.
Well, same thing.
No, that's not the big one that I was talking about.
Oh, it isn't?
No. That was the single beard turkey that I was talking about.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Again, work with us. It's probably
it's not that bad. Quit making excuses. It'll be all right.
I've only been up since 2:00 this morning. We're good.
The multiple beard turkey was a monster. He had four beards.
Yeah.
Every one of them were right at 10 inches long. He scored 108 by NWTF scoring.
It's ridiculous.
That's insane. And the guys doubled up. They said 1, 2, 3 shoot on that multiple beard turkey and an 8-inch bearded hen that won the bearded hen category.
Yep.
The same team won both.
That's
nuts. That's
ridiculous.
Crazy.
Yeah.
But,
ridiculous.
And then, if that wasn't enough, then Godzilla turkey was hanging there beside him.
Yeah.
He was a single bearded turkey. He had
14
inch beard, right at 2-inch spurs, and he weighed 24 pounds. He scored 78.
Yep, 78.
For a single bearded turkey, that's a freaking giant. 14-inch beard's a monster. I mean, that's ridiculous. That's way bigger than anything I've ever killed. The biggest turkey I've ever killed had a 12-inch beard, and I thought I'd killed a dinosaur.
Mm-hmm.
I mean.
Yeah. I couldn't imagine. I mean, it's huge.
Huge.
And you see it in person. You can But he had, what, 15, 20 birds hanging there?
Yeah.
And he obviously stood out.
Well, he looked like he had a set of fighting chicken knives attached to the back of his legs, literally what it looked like.
And it just is just about indescribable. I mean, it's big.
It was awesome. It was awesome. Yes. And those guys had been scouting that turkey. They'd been watching that turkey for a while.
Yeah.
I mean, they.
Like I said, they'd watched it for 4 years.
Yeah.
What they said on stage when they were talking about it.
And it was a local bird. It was right there within 15, 20 minutes of where the weigh-in was.
Yep.
And it won them $15,000.
$15,000. And guess what? They passed the polygraph.
They passed. I saw that.
Yep.
They probably didn't ask him, was there any corn laying around?
No. Because
when that guy said that on stage, they were just like,
about that. I know. No, sir.
You really want to test that out, cut them birds open, see what's in the gut.
That's it. Cut them up. Nah. It is all in fun. It is a good time. It really was.
We had a really good time. And that was just the start of it for us.
Yeah.
We got to go over, and we were standing on the edge of the lawn area, video and the presentation and all that stuff. Christian, go into what happened.
Well, then, you see here, we were recording the concerts and listening to everybody start singing and stuff. Well, one of our main, objectives of this whole trip was going here and talk to some of our sponsor guys, see if we can talk to some of our bone collector guys or real tree guys, just see how everything's rolling. And it kind of seemed like we weren't going to get to.
It didn't look real promising.
It is like, well, these guys are supposed to be rolling around, it's going on 7 o'clock, we're going to start the concerts, and I still ain't seen really nobody. I talked to Hal Schaefer for a little bit, talked to him for a few minutes. And
for the most part, those guys were staying back in the VIP area, though. They were not coming out into the crowd.
Well, they hadn't even been to the VIP area yet until the concert started.
Yeah.
But, like I say, except for Hal. We got to talk about how they went out. He went out to Missouri this week, and they were doing the Pimp My Deer Camp this week.
Yeah.
The drop zone. That was kind of cool. If you ain't checked it out, you should check that out. That's kind of cool.
I ain't got to see that yet.
They completely redone a hunting cabin in five days.
That's awesome.
With their sponsors. But anyways.
We needed that in South Carolina.
Yeah.
Something fierce.
That'd be awesome. That but anyways, awesome. Talk to him for a few minutes. Well, as the show starts going on, we're like, it's really looking unlikely.
Yeah.
Well, about, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes into the show, Red Atkins come up on stage with Nate Hosey, and they sing and having a good time. Well, Shane taps me on the shoulder, like, hey, there's Waddy. And here comes Mike Waddell in there in the VIP area. And they all go to eat and this, that, and the other. And I was like, well, we ain't going to bother him by no means, Let him eat whatever. So, like I say, still looking pretty down and out. That ain't going to happen.
Yeah.
Well, then out of nowhere, here come the marketing manager for Bone Collector. Hey, what are you doing? Good talking to you. Good seeing you. Stuff's great. Well, here come another guy. Hey, stuff looks good. Good seeing you. Good talking to you. Well, then Shane, you've killed.
Yeah.
Shane's killed.
He's over. Tired.
He's in a dead stare, blanked out, standing there, just barely hanging on alive. Dawson wasn't too far behind him, I think. He was there, but he wasn't too much there. And he's like, well, we're going to go on towards the truck. There ain't a whole lot going on. It ain't looking likely. It's like, well, almost.
Well, and the other boys were hanging out at the truck.
Yeah,
Josh and Samuel had already been to the truck, and they were.
Yeah.
There was as much going on in the parking lot as there was going on in the.
Yeah, there was a lot going on out there. So I was like, I'm going to stick it out here and see what happens. Well, how far? You boys don't leave. I mean, you're gone 5 minutes.
It wasn't even that. I just got to the truck.
Yeah. I mean, just had. Here comes another boy from Bone Collector, tap me on the shoulder. Hey, well, you working or whatever? I was like, well, here's going to be my cue to get out of this area, which I was in the public lawn or, wasn't VIP or nothing at that moment. Like, well, here comes my moment to get kicked out of here. And he's like, hey, if you're not doing nothing, come back here and have some beers with us. There we go.
Yeah.
Here's the open door.
Yeah.
And that's all we need, because like us being the show that we are, not a fully sponsored show. I mean, got great partners and great sponsors, but it's not. Most of his stuff comes out of our pocket.
Oh yeah,
big time majority.
Yeah, the majority of this
stuff. So anytime
stuff
we can
out
talk
out
to these
pockets.
Guys and make them happy and get all that working smooth, we want to. So they tell me that, like, here we go, here's our open door. We finally get to go back here and talk to these fellas for a few minutes. We got back here. Here I've texted Dawson and Shane. I was like, well, you just left too soon. We about to have some beers.
Yeah.
Do what?
I didn't even get the text. Dawson's like, look at this crap. I was like, I'm out of here. I'm gone.
You're gone.
I was like, at Peckerhead, I've been standing out there all night.
Finally get to talk to these guys. Well, here come Waddell, and everybody kind of flocked to him there.
Yeah.
That was in VIP that I don't think we're supposed to be there.
No, but there was a lot of people sleeping back there. They'd basically abandoned any post of anybody that was watching it.
And,
so they come back here and kind of flogged around him, and they were feeling pretty good, had a good evening, if you know what I mean. So by the time Waddy got to him, he's like, man, what are you into? I ain't seen you a long time. Man, I love your stuff. Who are you again? I mean, not actually, but that's how it felt for a split second.
The look on your face was priceless. We'd cut the camera off, and I'd give anything to see to have videoed the look on your face.
Well, the thing was, we just got done talking with, like, say, the marketing manager.
Yeah, like, I mean, we
man, Waddy and them guys love your show, and I'm like, that's awesome. I'm glad he's got to see it. And,
yeah.
I haven't talked to Waddell personally since, I don't know, back in the summer.
Yeah.
Of what is it? 2020.
Yeah.
I ain't seen him in person since Dixie Deer Classic, you know. And that's been a hot minute.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, you know, I'm glad to know. I mean, everybody's been crazy busy. That's the biggest thing.
Well, that's it.
And I was worried. Like, I haven't got to talk to these guys a whole lot. No, they're busy, but I want to know what they're thinking. And then he said, you know, got the good information. They like our stuff. Everything's going good. And then I talked to Waddy, and he's like, and how do I know you again? In a sense, I can't remember what it was.
I don't remember exactly what he said. You could tell he recognized you.
Yeah, he 100% knew who I was, but he couldn't quite figure out who I was.
Yeah, he was struggling in that moment.
Yeah, I was like, just about jerked a tear. I was like, well, boys, he really don't
remember. I'm going to cry.
I looked at him kind of funny, and I looked back at Shane kind of funny. It's like, you know, Appalachian holler hunters.
I almost started laughing. Mm. I was trying to, like, be professional and keep a straight face.
I didn't know what to do.
And I almost just about heartbroken laughing.
I mean, it's all happened in a matter of 3 seconds.
3 seconds. It was fast.
But it was real quick, but it felt like an eternity standing there looking. I'm like, God, what have we got into? I guess it's going to be the end of it right here. It's the end of it. But no, it took him a second to figure out what was going on. He's like, oh, yeah, I love your stuff. You're doing great. It's heck yeah. Have you met Culpepper yet?
Yeah. Then he started introducing us to the rest of the guys.
Yeah, and that's where it got cool.
It got awesome.
We talked to everybody in the business. Really good for us.
I mean, he's out there for
2 hours at least.
At least.
Backstage while Dustin Lynch and the boys up on stage having a ball.
Well, and then they would come through and they just like, hey, who are you guys?
Who are you guys? It's good seeing you.
Nice seeing y'all. So we're talking to Dustin Lynch. We're talking to
Tyler Farr. All these guys. Buck Commander guys.
Nate Hosey and the guys from Headhunters TV.
Yeah, Headhunters TV, those guys.
Those guys. Great guys. Those are stand-up
really
guys.
Good. Gosh, yeah.
And then
you couldn't ask for better people. I mean, we talked and talked and talked and rubbed elbows, had a good time.
Had a blast.
Met all kinds of Realtree camera guys. I mean, we had two or three of those guys. The guy that films for David Blanton, he got to talk to us for a few minutes.
We were way out of our league in that moment.
It's one of those moments like, man, we're going to be professional as we can about advertising our companies because we fully believe in everything. If we advertise for them, we 100% believe our stuff is the best.
Yeah.
We're going to keep it professional as possible. Then you see these guys in person and you've looked up to for your whole entire life watching their videos. You're like, wow, this is kind of unreal. No matter how many times you do it, you know.
It's definitely a
surreal moment.
It sure is.
No matter what it is. Anytime you get to meet and talk with the heroes, it's just kind of unreal for a few moments.
Yeah.
For a few minutes. Well, for 2 hours if he was us.
Yeah. Yeah, but it was more than a few minutes. It was 2 hours. And you can see we went live a couple times. And every time we go live, you can see him walking through the frame and stuff right there with us.
I only got asked a time or two if we were supposed to be there or not and had to pull the old, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We are.
They asked us to come back here.
You know us. We're those holler hunter boys. Everybody else knows us. You don't know us. You don't know who we are. Mm. You know. And it is a heck of, I mean, could not ask for a better time. It turned out really good. We got to talk to our boys, and we got some stuff lined up coming up.
It's
going to be a ball.
It was for sure a successful event for us.
Very successful. I cannot wait till next year's event. They haven't announced that they're doing it. It's the first annual, but they've got to do it.
They're bound to do it.
I mean, it was a heck of a time. It's awesome.
I don't know that they made the amount of money they thought they were going to make on that deal, but
right. There wasn't quite a bit of turnout because you still got a lot of COVID stuff going on. There's still many people.
Well, but that's what made it so cool because we haven't been able to see any live music in a year.
None. And I love concerts, my bad. So I was really
interested
to hear some
live
music. This
was like right in your face, even for the people that weren't back where we were.
Yeah.
I mean, they were right up next to the stage. It was a very kind of personal event. It was just right there, just them and
right.
There was, 200 people out in the crowd maybe?
300 or so. It's quite a bit.
Yeah, but
once they started filling in, there's a lot.
Not what you would normally have at a concert with Dustin Lynch and Tyler Farr and those guys. I mean,
that's basically your own private party.
Yeah, exactly.
And then, well, the night grew on, and then you got Waddell and Nick Mutt and all them boys up on stage picking guitar, having a good time. Talk about a heck of a time.
It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
You couldn't have asked for a better time. But I'm really looking forward to next year. Hopefully we can get some more Holler Hunter boys down there. I cannot wait.
I'm probably going to enter the competition.
We're going for blood next year, boys.
Yeah. Yes.
I don't know. I couldn't ask for any more than what happened this year. If we kill the biggest turkey, so be it. But just going down there, it was well worth the money just to go down there and experience the things.
Right. Well, any time at all, you get to go hunt with your buddies, whether it's for a day or for a couple of days, anytime, anywhere, you're going to have a good time. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's proven time and time again. We go to South Carolina, I mean, we have a ball.
Yeah.
I mean, anytime you get to go and hang out with your buddies.
Well, me and Samuel had an agreement. I told him I'll pay the entry fee if you'll pay for the fuel.
Yeah, there we go.
And so I made him fill the truck up. I timed it where we filled the truck up within an hour of the house. And I called him on Thursday of this week. And he said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm sitting at a gas station for the first time this week. I said, I've been running off at Sam Gates fuel all week long.
That's
and I'm going to be
I'm
honest. I told
about.
Him, I said, my exhaust smells just a little bit sweeter when I know it's your money running through this.
Heck yeah.
But that's awesome. Had a blast. We had a really good time.
It is a really good time.
All right, fellas. Well, let's go into our second break, and we will be back shortly with the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast.
This segment of the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast is brought to you by Mountaineer Outfitters, the official outfitters of Appalachian Holler Hunters. Visit them online on Facebook or Instagram, or visit them in person at 65 Haynes Road in Newland, North Carolina. Open 8 to 5 Monday through Friday, 8 to 12 on Saturdays. Stop by and see them today for all your hunting and shooting sport needs. Man, I was going down the road. You see all them turkeys down there at Farmer Johnson's place?
Nah, man, I didn't see them.
Man, there was at least 20 or 30 of them out there strutting around this morning.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. We need to get on them.
Well, that's right, we do. But the thing is, he won't let nobody hunt that place there.
Man, that ain't no problem. We can get on the Onyx Hunt app. We can find who owns the properties around them, get permission to go hunt them, and get after them.
Really? If I'd have known that, I'd have been on birds all over the county last year.
Yeah, man, you can mark waypoints. You can see topo maps, and you can see neighboring parcels, so you can hunt all around him. So if you got that stubborn landowner that won't let you on it, find out who owns the property beside him and go hunt.
Well, if that's the case, I'm going to download that thing right now.
Download it, man, and get started. All right, guys, we are back with the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast. This is going to be our last section for tonight. We're all pretty whooped, but Dawson's got us a good story about a turkey hunt this week.
Yeah.
After we got back from Strutmasters, everything kind of went back to normal, and everybody hit the woods. Most everybody hit the woods.
Yeah.
The boys are really chasing, doing a good job getting on some birds.
18 birds. Let's just throw it out there again.
That's a lot of birds.
Just throw it out there one more time. 18
birds. And it's opening week.
It's still technically opening week of North Carolina hunting season.
We still got 3 more weeks.
Yeah,
I still got 2 tags in South Carolina that probably never going to be filled. But
don't tell me about it.
Ain't even going to get down there. Anyway,
it hurts.
Anyway. Dawson, tell us a little story.
So, I was actually going to be working Friday, and boss calls me and says, I ain't got nothing lined up, so you should take tomorrow off. And I said, okay, cool, I'll go kill a turkey. And I've actually never killed a turkey until the other day. And I called my cousin Joey, and he says, yeah, let's go. We hunted up behind his dad's house. He said, I've heard birds up here before, so we figured we'd go give it a shot. And we get up there. We had to walk a long ways up through a tree field and get on top and blow an owl hoot and never hear nothing. The wind's blowing pretty bad. I mean, it was frigid cold, too, so that wind.
It seemed like. Every time I went out this week, it was windy.
It was cold and windy. But we got up there, blowed out a hoot, never heard nothing. And Joey says, well, let's walk over here and call off into this other holler and get over there. And we're walking over there, and I hear, like, in my mind, obviously, it sounded like a gobble, but it didn't sound like a gobble. It just sounded like a blah.
Right. Yeah.
And I told Joey, I said, was that a gobble? And he said, I don't know. I didn't hear it. And so I tossed my call in my mouth, and I called, and two birds just, bah! And I hit the deck. I start freaking out. And we slip down this logging road and get set up, and I call again. They answer, and I think they were still on the limb when I called the first time, and they had flew down in between calling. Called again, they answered, and they were working their way. And in between times that I would call, there was a hen with them, evidently, and she was raising Cain.
Yeah.
And they was gobbling at her, too. So, but I called for a while. Birds kept getting closer and closer, and I finally got set down in the middle of the road, and Joey sits behind me, and we wait a second, and I start hearing crunching of leaves, and Joey starts calling. He can't hear it, and he starts calling, and these birds hammer, and I'm not joking, it rattled my chest. They were close.
God's sakes.
And I'm actually facing the wrong way, then the birds are coming, so they're like 25 yards at this point, coming through a big old briar thicket, can't see nothing, I can't see them. I spin around real easy, and I hadn't no sooner got spun around, and I see one's head poke up over a log. And
yeah.
I shoulder my gun, and as soon as it steps out in the road, I shoot. And I didn't realize I hit the bird because I didn't think they both had stepped up in the road.
Yeah.
And the other one took flight, and I shooted it, missed both shots.
Yeah.
And I'm just standing there like, really? Did I just do that? And my cousin says, Dawson, you're joking. And about that time, I just turned and looked up the road where I'd fired the first shot, and I'd flopping.
Seen you flopping
him. I killed him. And I just took off running. I was excited, screaming. And when I got up there, I said, hell yeah! You know, got real loud. I was tickled to death. First bird.
Heck yeah.
And it was a heck of a bird, too. Yeah, it was a nice bird.
For my first one, that was a really, really good bird. I would have shot a one hair Jake. I mean, I was just wanting to kill my first turkey, you know.
I hear you.
But it had a 10-inch beard and 7/8 spurs on both sides.
God, yeah. So.
And the video you showed us is hilarious. Yeah. When you say thicket, it was thick.
It was thick.
I was like, how in the crap is he shooting a turkey in that mess?
Yeah. But,
welcome to the Appalachian Mountains. Everything you hunt's going to be in the thickest mess you find.
You would think so, yeah.
That's how it seems to be.
It's... And you wouldn't think a turkey would be able to strut in that mess.
No.
I mean,
you look at it, there's like, no, there ain't no way.
There's no way.
Well, but guess what?
I actually did hear, you know, spitting and drumming. So they evidently.
Yeah, they were blown up.
Right.
But
that's awesome.
So, question, is this your first turkey season of hunting turkeys?
Yes, this is the first year I've hunted turkeys.
Well, you're off to a good start. First week in North Carolina hunting season, you've got or not.
I've hunted every day this week. So.
That's God, awesome.
Yeah. Heck, yeah.
That's awesome.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yet off. To be in the woods in western North Carolina.
We need to get after it.
I've not walked out into the woods in western North Carolina. Man. I've been busy this week.
Yeah.
Uncle Joe's keeping us busy in the gun show.
Yeah.
He's the best gun salesman we've ever seen. So.
Yeah, for sure, without a doubt.
So I was telling you guys, I had a little run-in with some boys this week.
Oh, yeah, your trespasser guys.
Yeah. And
tell us about it. I'm dying to hear it.
It cracked me up. I was just coming back in yesterday afternoon. Me and Parker had went out to eat dinner. We eat early because I'm apparently like 33 going on 85.
Older than dirt.
I eat at 6 o'clock and I go to bed by 8. I don't know how I've got in that cycle. This here is like... It's 11:50. This is going pretty heavy for me. I haven't seen this late in a long time, but
yeah.
Anyway, we're coming back in, and we've talked about it on the last podcast. I just typically have run-ins with some funny people when it has anything to do with fishing, and so we're coming down the hill, and I see a truck parked out here by the pond, and we have this pond out in front of the dealership.
Yep.
We allow them to use it for the kids' fishing day every year, but past that, we cannot let people fish out here. Right. Our insurance company, they're not very particular about a lot of stuff, but that's one thing that they are very picky about.
period, with insurance are ridiculous.
It's ridiculous. It's, and if just, they catch you, a lot, just
same with every company.
If you don't post it and you don't patrol it, they'll triple your insurance rate. Yep. And it's bad enough on a building this size.
Yeah.
So I hate to run people out of here, but we've got it posted. I mean, there's posted signs everywhere.
Yeah. Right.
And so most people will see those posted signs, but every year you get two or three.
Right.
That just can't resist the temptation. Nah. And so I pull in, and there's two boys sitting down there, black truck down there, and one of them, he sees me turning in, he walks over to the back of the truck and acts like he's tying on a spinner. Right. The other one just standing there casting away and casting away.
Right.
And I pull up, my roll the window down, and he turns around and kind of looks at me and throws his head up. I'm like, hey, man, what's up? He's like, I'm not much, and about that time he misses one. He sets the hook and misses one. Mm. And he's like, dang it. And I said, hey, man, you do me a favor? He goes, what? I said, can you tell me what that sign right beside your head says? And he turns around, and there's a posted sign that's 3 feet from his head. Man. And he's like, oh. And, like, it just deflated him.
Yeah.
And I just start laughing, and he's like, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Don't call the cops. I'm like, dude, I ain't going to call the cops. But I was like, we can't allow people to fish here. Y'all going to have to go. And he's like, okay, okay. Can I have one more cast? And I start
dying. You can't blame him for trying. No, you, like, just missed one. You got to try.
I was like, I respect the hustle, but nah, man, y'all got to go. Y'all got to go. But that's the same way with the guy last year. I pull in, and there's a van parked across the road at a church. He parked over there and walked around the store and all the way around the yard and was standing out here in the yard fishing. Oh. And I pulled up, and I was like, hey, man, you know there's no fishing out here, don't you? They've posted signs everywhere. He's like, yeah, yeah, I know. And I said,
then what are you doing?
What are you doing? He said, man, I've been driving by this place for 6 months. And he said, I couldn't help it. I couldn't resist. He said, I couldn't do it anymore. He said, I had to come out here. And I said, well, you doing any good? He said, no, I've not been here long. I was like, all right, man, well, if you don't care, just get your stuff and go on.
Yeah.
I ain't going to call the law or anything like that, but you got to go. We can't have people out here.
You love to see it, but you hate to see it. Well, you love to see people as excited about getting out and fishing.
I love to see people. And if it was up to me, I'd let them, everyone, come in here and fish. But just as soon as you did, you'd have that one jackhole that would get out here and trip and try to sue you.
One meth head from Tennessee, it comes out here and drowns in your pond.
Well, or just
trouble.
Steps in a hole and breaks an ankle and wants to sue you. And it just, it's...
Too much liability.
It's there, too much liability there. Yep.
I mean, it's just the unfortunate part of it.
And I hate being that guy, especially with young guys, because these guys were 16, 17 years old.
Right.
And that's what we need. We need kids that age getting out.
Yeah.
Hey, I've got good news, though. There's good news to that. There's this great app called Onyx Hunt, and you can find a lot of places to fish on that. Oh, and Outdoor Access. You can find places to fish off of that app, too.
Yeah.
Yep.
Plenty of ways to find places to fish.
Yeah. Yeah, there's, well.
But that being said, this place is pretty tempting.
We've got miles of river here.
Yeah.
And it will be stocked on Monday.
That is right.
I actually seen the stock truck yesterday in Minneapolis.
They were stocking North Tow.
Yep.
They stocked North Tow yesterday.
Yep.
Or it was supposed to have been on Friday. That was yesterday.
Yeah. Yesterday is Friday.
That was yesterday.
Actually, the day before yesterday, I think. Is it midnight yet?
Not yet. We're at 10:54, so.
It's close. We're getting close. But anyways, like I said, there's plenty of places to find fish.
Plenty of places.
You love to see it, but you hate to see it. But liability and trespassers and people suck and life goes on and you go on.
Yep, and it never fails when it comes to fishing. I always run into some of the most random things when it comes to fishing. It just makes you got to laugh about it. If not, you just get mad and there ain't no reason to live life like that.
Why not? Well, while we're speaking of fishing, before we sign off here, I think it's probably a pretty good time to semi-sort announce that we're in the works of putting together some type of small fishing tournament.
Yep.
With Appalachian Holler Hunters, you know, kind of how we done our Youth Turkey Day. We're wanting to do something along the lines of a trout day for kids up here in Avery County. So be on the lookout for that in the coming weeks.
Well, and don't forget the guys that helped us do the barbecue for the turkey hunt are all members of the
Hunters Helping Kids.
It ain't Hunters Helping Kids. It's the other group. Anyway, they're putting on the Kids Fishing Day out here Father's Day weekend.
Father's Day weekend.
Father's Day weekend. It is back on. Last year they weren't able to do it because of COVID.
Hey, if you want to fish this pond, you don't have to trespass. As long as you're under 17, you can come out here and fish this pond.
You can come out here and fish this pond. They are covered by a $5 million policy.
There you go.
They get a one-day liability policy to cover everything out here, but they are going to be able to do it this year.
That's what I'm talking about.
Awesome. So they're
this pond out here is the whole reason we're doing what we're doing. It goes back to that story, which everybody around me's heard 1,000 times.
High Country Sportsman's Coalition.
That's it. Yeah. That's it.
I couldn't had a brain fart there for just a second.
We're doing pretty good for as late as it is. I mean, that was good. I'm surprised you hit that.
It would have come back to me.
It'd get you by the time we close my doors. Oh, that's what it is.
There's a lot up here. But anyway, that is how our first week of turkey season has gone, guys. It has been a lot of ups, a lot of downs, a lot of ups for a lot of guys on our team.
Yes. Most everybody's having luck in Tennessee right now. Everybody that's hunting on the holler hunter teams mostly been done in Tennessee.
Killing some crazy looking birds over
Wild
there.
Wild birds. Red looking, bronze looking.
Yeah, I don't know. They need to quit hunting that guy's pen.
That's what I'm thinking.
They're going to have to get out of turkey lot.
That's what I'm thinking.
We're going to have to try some of this in the woods next time. But
yeah, I think we've only got two in North Carolina, aside from youth kids.
Yeah.
Just Mitch and Matthew, the only two that's got her done in North Carolina. Oh, well, it's one guy beside me, but he don't count.
Don't forget old Dalton over there.
Had to say it.
Couldn't let it go.
Had to fit in once more. But all right, I guess guys. That'll probably.
I'm out of it. I ain't got nothing else to say.
I don't either. I mean, it's probably not our best show, but look, guess what? We got to feed the fans.
That's right.
We got to have something to listen to.
5 o'clock.
But once again, guys, we want to thank you for listening to the podcast. No matter where you're listening to this, whether it's on Apple Podcasts or Spotify or on YouTube, like, subscribe, give us a rating, write us a review. We want to thank all our sponsors and all the guys that support us, Bone Collector, Rowdy Energy, Realtree, Big and J, Vortex Optics, everybody that's looking after us right now and helping us out with this thing.
Yes.
A big thank you to all those guys.
Mountaineer Outfitters, if you know Shane, I guess can't thank yourself.
I can't thank myself.
In the Mountaineer Outfitter studio.
Yeah. But we just want to say thank you to everybody that's supporting us and helping us get through this stuff. And
We've got some exciting stuff coming.
Oh, yeah. We've got some short videos coming up.
We're working into season two, new intro, promo videos. We've got some awesome stuff coming.
Yep.
And we've got some killer turkey footage to show everybody.
Not to mention, we got deer season coming back.
Deer season is coming back.
I'm so excited
for
deer
ready?
Season. Oh, I'm.
And bear season. I am so excited for this bear season. You have no idea how much I'm looking forward to getting in here and filming some bear hunting this year.
We're going to get some more bear hunting on camera this year.
Oh, I'm excited.
I'm going to grab my camera and chase them boys around.
It's kind of funny. All these boys got these tacticams running for turkey season. Like, God, I can't believe we didn't have these in bear season. When they're thinking the stuff we've got, it's like they've discovered fire. I mean, you've got kids excited as kids on Christmas morning.
Yeah.
These tacticams looking forward to bear season. One in particular, Sam Clausen.
Oh, thank you to tacticam.
And thank you to tacticam.
Helping
and federal
us out.
Ammunition and Onyx Hunt maps and
everyone else that has been right there with us.
Everybody that's helped do this. I mean, if it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be able to do it like we're doing it right now.
So, guys. Sorry we missed a week. I don't know whether we're going to be on every week or every other week, but we will get back with another one as quick as we can. But
we will. We'll have a better answer for that in the coming days.
Yeah. But anyway, guys, I think that's going to do it for us. But thank you for listening to the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast.
Thank you much.
Have a good one, guys.
See you guys.
Dawson sucks. This segment of the Back 40 Skull Sessions podcast is brought to you by Realtree, the official camo pattern of the Appalachian Holler Hunters. Be sure to check out Realtree's newest pattern, Realtree Timber, to stay concealed all season long.